And writing as we take up our quills. Let's meet our scribblers in fine feathers. It's Lou Sanders. Rocking a few feathers. It's Tom Allen. Knock me down with a feather. It's Jimmy Carr. And always tickling our fancy. Alan Davis. Let's get writing. Lou goes.
That's nice.
Tom goes. Jimmy goes. And Alan goes. To take notes, your own quill pens are on your desk. Ooh. But why don't we tend to use them anymore?
Does anyone use a pen anymore? I don't even use a pen.
Do you not?
When did you last write something down? You type it.
Also, if people are, my mum is allergic to feathers.
And is she? She couldn't have written anything.
There used to be a name for that. That was called being illiterate.
Ah, no. My dad. My mum can actually write and read.
They were the writing instrument of choice for almost 1,500 years, but they required a lot of upkeep. So basically, not very efficient. You could write maybe 3 or 4 letters at a time, and then you'd run out of ink, and they regularly needed sharpening. So the pen part of a penknife... Anybody know where the word pen in penknife comes from?
Oh, from sharpening pens.
Yes, and it comes from penna, which is Latin for feather. So that is why we call it a penknife.
Oh, did you hear that? That was a lovely... Tell that to someone in a pub.
So, in order to make a quill pen, what you're going to have to do, first of all?
You're going to have to catch a bird.
Yes. It has to be a feather from a live bird, is the first thing. And then there's a hierarchy of quills. So, Jimmy, you've got the goose.
Is that like an everyday...
It is, I'm afraid. It's
working
common.
Pen.
Common a garden, that one.
When you say a live bird, it's not... Is it live for long? I mean,
I mean, once you've plucked a bird's feather, it will grow back. It'll take about a year, probably, for it to grow back again.
So ye olde W.H. Smiths would have been just a bunch of birds and you're plucking birds one at a time.
Well,
I'll be back in a year for a refill.
There was a real problem in the 19th century. They began to experience a real shortage of quills. Why might that be?
Oh, avian flu or something. Was it?
No, just more people could read and write, darling.
Very dark mind, Tom. Very dark.
I read a really interesting thing that Clive James wrote about typewriters. He said about the noise that writing used to make. Mm. So when he wrote his first memoir, he wrote it on a typewriter. It was a terrific racket all day long.
It was a phenomenal noise.
Every line.
And I still, that's a sign of my age, because I still do that when
on an iPad, you'll do that.
Yeah, I know, it's very annoying.
I would like to have that effect when I press return, that it goes ting. Just so other people on the train in the quiet carriage could be
living. You know when you hear people on their phone and they haven't turned the keypad tones on?
Yes. Oh, it's so endearing, isn't it?
Oh, that was a good noise as well.
To them, you know you can turn that off, don't you?
Do you? Are you bold like that?
Yeah, just say, do you want me to do it for you?
Just throw the phone at you.
Now, you've got a crow feather.
Oh, thanks.
These were for artistic people. They were specifically for drawing thin lines. Oh. So you might be doing an architectural drawing or some such thing.
You might be drawing my body. You get it.
You've got a swan quill.
Oh, lovely.
And that's only the best. So Elizabeth the First, she preferred swan. But the everyday one, Thomas Jefferson kept his own geese.
I was so pleased when I got given this, and now I feel like...
Jimmy?
No, you're right-handed.
Yeah, I'm right-handed, yeah, yeah.
You would need a quill from a left wing if you were right-handed, because you don't want the feather to be hitting you in the face.
Oh, that must have been awful, then, if they weren't killing the birds and they were just bald on one side. Just flying in circles, going, well, this one still works.
If bald eagles lose a feather on one wing, they will shed it on the same one on the other side.
Wow.
Why might they do that?
Fashion.
Yes.
So, wait, so you pull out one, they pull out the other. That's fascinating.
Yeah, but what's that, though? What's that?
It's a seagull going to the library.
No, coming back from the library.
Oh, sorry.
Sandy, I have a question.
Darling.
I mean, it's all very well talking about feathers. Why didn't they just sharpen a stick?
It has, like, a little reservoir inside it.
That's where the ink goes.
The ink can go inside, whereas a stick, less successful. And, in fact, one of the sort of forerunners of the fountain pen, they worked out that they could have a little steel holder and you could actually cut one of these into five or six little nibs, and then we eventually get to the fountain pen. But there are some advantages to the quill, because it can hold certain inks which would clog a fountain pen, like India ink, for example. Now, goose feathers are still used. For what purpose might you still use a goose feather?
Oh, I've got that as well.
Pillows and duvets.
Pillows and duvets. And duvets. Thank you. What is this game? There are no rules.
It's enormous.
Absolute Wild West here.
What else?
A goose himself or herself are using the feathers.
One of the answers we had thought of, but yes, yes, goose feathers still weirdly in use by the geese.
Yes. fashion.
Fashion. No, so sport.
Oh. Archery.
Shuttlecocks.
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 That was absolutely enormous. Look out! Look out! The Giants are playing on the next court!
has to be made, a shuttlecock, from the left wing of a goose in order that it spins clockwise when it is struck. What?
This is a great show. I'm learning.
The name Federer, like in, as in Roger Federer.
Greatest ever tennis player.
Yeah. OK, his name means one who trades in quills. Oh. So, really, he should have been a badminton player.
Does he know?
I bet he'd pick it up, wouldn't he, badminton?
Do you think?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah. You've wasted your life, Roger.
The real money's in badminton.
Now, where might you be well advised to skip the queue?
Well, they don't like to queue in France.
Or Italy.
Or Italy.
They're really, so... very pushy, especially the elderly in Italy.
Yeah.
Right.
They burrow in, the little Italian women, they burrow right into the heart of the queue and then you can't get them out. They're in the front.
I like that. A tiny Italian woman just pushing by everyone to the front. I go, good. Yeah.
Scusi, scusi, good. Scusi, scusi, scusi. And then she's in the front and no one knows how to stop her.
She's not got long left. Yeah. I think they should be allowed to go to the front.
Yeah, she's going to die.
People with kids should be right at the back. They've got ages.
Yeah.
Maybe they should just do queuing by longevity. How long do you think you've got?
You shouldn't queue in hospital. Well, my friend skipped the queue, but she'd cut her finger off, so they were like, yeah, come to the front.
Yes, that's quite a serious thing, isn't it?
Well, as well, because she can't, when they come out and go, who's next, she was not in a position to go like...
So, it's not actually about queuing in terms of a physical queue, it's about the letter Q. Yes, do you write it?
Yes, oh. The surname Smith. What? You don't need a queue in that, skip it. I just give myself 10 points there.
Are there some languages where there isn't a queue?
Well, the letter Q was actually banned in Turkey until 2013, along with two other letters, the X and the W.
It's a language thing.
It is a language thing, darling. But the real issue is that the Turkish language doesn't use the letter Q, but the Kurdish one does. And there was a lot of anti-Kurdish sentiment in Turkey, and so those letters were not allowed to appear in official documents, and people were not allowed to use them when naming their children. Until the early 1990s, it was illegal in Turkey for the 15 to 20 million Kurds, you're talking about 20% of the population, to use any Kurdish at all in public. And it was only since 2013 that you are actually allowed to use the letter Q once more in Turkey.
In Turkey, would they not have quavers then?
Well, that's why there's been an outcry.
Yeah.
People are a little bit annoyed about the sort of repression of the Kurdish people, but mainly
quavers.
Those lovely cheesy snacks.
Now, I'm going to play the sound of someone typing. What do you think they are trying to say?
We don't know any Shakespeare. We're only monkeys.
So why might we know, just from the sound, what somebody is actually trying to say?
Do they have a slightly different pitch, all of the buttons?
Yeah, so it's the QWERTY keyboard, yeah. And it can be translated, if you like, to work out what we are typing.
No.
If you had just a microphone, hackers would be able to discover your logins, your password, any other confidential information that you might be typing, because each key hits a different part of the keyboard's underplate, and there is a slightly different sound for every single one. And there's an algorithm which can be used to work out which sound corresponds with which letter.
Jimmy looks worried.
I'm going to have to learn to write again. Presumably, for each keyboard, it would be different.
Well, you just need 10 minutes with one keyboard with a microphone.
But is this for a typewriter or for a keyboard?
For a computer keyboard. Computer scientists at the University of California in Berkeley estimate hackers would need 10 minutes and they could crack anybody's computer code.
What about an iPad?
I don't think it would work on that, but it would work on a computer.
Do your dirty work on an iPad, Jimmy.
My dirty work?
And now I imagine that dirty work is Jimmy's password.
Boys, because you don't type with two hands like that. Every time I'm on a train, there's some boy typing and he's doing this.
Yeah. Mavis Deacon did me proud, that little typing thing.
Did you learn to type?
Oh, yeah.
When I was at school, we were all taught to type, and they used to tie an apron to the top of the typewriter and then round your neck, and then so you had to type underneath the apron so you couldn't see.
At the boys' school, Sandy, you're taught to dictate.
Key part of that word is dick.
That was very good. Could you just take that down for us?
We can actually reveal, Alan, what was being typed. Alan.
Say blue. Or 100 points. Blue well.
Yeah, it's too late now. Oh. Those buzzers that we played at the very beginning, it's from the Typewriter Symphony. It was actually the theme tune on the news quiz on Radio 4. It still is. A guy called Leroy Anderson, American composer, who wrote it where the typewriter is used as a percussion instrument. It's one of my favourites. Have a quick look at this video. Isn't that wonderful?
That's a guy that forgot his instrument and refused to back down.
It's a trained percussionist who does it. They slightly cheat. They modify the typewriter so only two keys are working. So otherwise you'd get it jammed, wouldn't you, if you played like that? And I absolutely love it. Now, on to a question about spy novels. What was the name of James Bond's gadget expert?
Q.
Q. No, in the films, but not in the novels. Q does not appear in
But you know there are James Bond films.
Yes.
And he's called Q in them, yes, so but it's sort of right, isn't it?
But in the original novels, only the Q branch is mentioned. And in the question, I did ask about the spy novels.
That's the problem, I don't listen.
No, because you're a man and you're too busy dictating.
So Q, the character Q, is thought to be based on a real inventor called Charles Fraser Smith, and he worked for the clothing department of the Ministry of Supply. Of course, his real job was coming up with gadgets for the Secret Service. They were called Q gadgets after the World War I Q ships. So these were warships which were disguised as freighters, and they got their name from their home port, Queenstown, in Ireland. And they looked like a perfectly ordinary freighter, and they had cargo and all that kind of thing. In fact, it was to lure U-boats up to the surface, and as soon as the U-boat came up, they would reveal their unbelievable armaments. I mean, unbelievably brave work. 44 Q ships were destroyed, but they also managed to destroy 15 U-boats. So that is where the Q thing comes from. It comes from these Q ships. Wow. I love, love, love the music to James Bond. Let's have a quick listen to the original James Bond theme. It music composer is a man called Monty Norman, and it actually comes from a song about a man with an unlucky sneeze, which he reworked into the James Bond theme. It was originally called Bad Sign, Good Sign, and it didn't sound at all like the original song. Have a listen to this.
Some onion bulges, please.
I was born with this unlucky sneeze, and what is worse, I came into the world the wrong way round. Fun
okay, it's all not,
this is surely
no,
bullshit.
This is true. V.S. Lethal's novel, A House for Mr. Biswas, is a wonderful novel, and Mr. Biswas has a terrible sneeze and it's unlucky for him. And Monty Norman wrote a musical version of this, which was not a huge success. He was later hired to write the music for the first Bond film, which was Dr. No. He reworked the theme tune into the James Bond theme tune. So we thought we'd do a bit of, I'm going to call it karaoke, because it starts with a Q. We're going to try and see if we can sing the original James Bond theme tune. So the words are going to come up on the screen for you. That's what we're going to
do. I was born with this unlucky sneeze, and what is worse, I came into the world the wrong way round. It's all a great, I'm the reason why my father fell into the village pond and drowned.
No. You know what, I now don't believe you when you say it wasn't a huge hit. Yeah. Now I can't understand.
I'd rather watch that than James Bond.
You fell into the village pond and drowned.
It's a very sad story.
Is it a true story?
No.
We've been expecting you, Mr. Bond. We heard you sneezing all the way down the corridor.
Bloody
out. My name is Pond.
James Pond.
Anyway, here is my next question. What would you find in Mrs. Q's memoirs?
I like the image you've used, by the way, that you think a key might be needed to undo a piece of string.
Well, it is possibly the key to her heart, my darling.
You don't know about love, do you?
I've never experienced it. Well, I joke. I've had a lot of love on very short-term bases.
My dressing room door is always open.
And mine has a key. So, early 19th century, Mrs. Q.
Mrs. Q's memoirs. Was it a fake name for someone with a salacious memoir?
Yeah, it was a woman called Harriet Wilson. She was a courtesan.
I love that. We say sex worker now.
So she started her career at age 15 as a mistress of Lord Craven, and she took lots of lovers. Some people say the Prince Regent. We have no evidence for that. When she announced that she was going to write her memoirs, she said any concerned gentleman could pay £200 to avoid being written about. Among those that she wrote to and said, do you want me to leave you out, was Arthur Wellesley, Duke of Wellington, who rather famously said, publish and be damned. So, published in 1825, it was four volumes, and it was, unbelievably popular. So popular, a barrier had to be set up outside the publishers' offices, and the publishers and Wilson went on to make £10,000, which at the time was an enormous amount of money. It has the great opening line in these memoirs. I shall not say how and why I became, at the age of 15, the mistress of the Earl of Craven. It's a fantastic opening. Anybody think of a book that kind of mirrors this situation recently?
Well, I suppose Stormy Daniels.
Stormy Daniels, absolutely. She said that, of course, that Donald Trump had paid to keep their affair secret.
I've not read the book. I've watched a lot of her films, but... ..cover similar areas.
The chapter concerning Trump begins, OK, so did you just skip to this chapter? what she says is, my life is a lot more interesting than an encounter with Donald Trump, but I get it. Still, of all the people who I had sex with, why couldn't the world obsess over one of the hot ones? And then she went on tour, Make America Horny Again.
She's working as a stand-up comedian now.
Really?
Yeah.
She's funny.
Yeah. Now, from one form of artistic expression to another, what is the most disgusting panel you can think of?
Oh, goodness, I've forgotten about that picture. It does look like I'm sort of merging into Alan.
I'd like to take a moment, Sandy, to thank you for the nasal trimmers you got me for Christmas.
It does look like you're saying, like, look, I've got nothing up my nose, OK?
So it's the letter Q we are looking for. What else might you have in a...
I'm absolutely stumped, actually. Sam.
OK, yeah, so the answer is quilts.
Quilts?
Quilts, yeah.
Oh, well, we were never going to get quilts.
Well, I think that is the point of the programme.
Really well.
Yes, you did very well. There's a woman called Anna Demetriou. She was the 2018 president of the Science and Arts section of the British Science Association, and she made a quilt where every panel was impregnated with MRSA bacteria. Ooh. Now, of course, she'd heavily treated it, so it wasn't going to kill you to actually hold the quilt up. It is Staphylococcus or Rheus bacteria, so MRSA is the deadly strain of this, and what she was trying to do was to highlight the problem of antibiotic resistance. Ooh. Unpleasantly, I think. She got the bacteria out of her own nose and grew it on the quilt.
We did that to the Native Americans, didn't we? We gave them quilts with smallpox.
You're right, they did give out blankets infected with smallpox in order to subdue, they called it, the Native American
population.
So what
point was she making with this?
She's just trying to show us the real issue that we're having at the moment with antibiotic resistances. In fact, the whole thing about making quilts and so on goes much further. So during various wars in the 19th century, it was very common for soldiers to make rather intricate quilts, often made from scraps of uniform. They were known as convalescence quilts. And some of the most complex examples have up to 25,000 pieces of fabric in them. When I was a child, duvets were called continental quilts. Ooh. Does anybody remember that?
Yeah.
Continental quilts.
I remember them starting. I just remember going to a hotel and it didn't have sheets and blankets. And we really didn't know what to do with ourselves. Tuck it in, now it's going to fall. And some of them did fall off.
They first came to Britain in about 1964, and it was Habitat who advertised them, saying that you could make a bed so quickly, just a few shakes, that even a man could do it.
And how wrong they were, because getting that cover on...
Yeah, this is what we're going to do. So, you've each got a quilt and a cover.
Right.
So we're going to have a very quick competition.
Couldn't be easier.
To see who can be quickest.
Hang on, I haven't undone the bow yet. I haven't got my key.
Get your quilt out. We're going to do it all at the same time.
Wait, okay.
Is everybody...
I can't find the opening, Sandy.
Hang on, can we open it? Where do we start?
Can't find my thing.
OK, ready? One, two, three,
go.
No,
I'm not ready, I'm not ready. I'm never near ready. Oh, my God!
Mine's buttoned up. That's not fair.
Jimmy!
Yes.
Sally, he has staff to do it for him.
Are you all right? Mind your hair.
What happened? I think it's all right. I did, yeah. I mean...
Jimmy!
Wow. I think I'm not the only one who's amazed it stayed on.
We specially got a duvet cover for you with blue whales on. We were very pleased. Are you all right? So I think, no question about it, Lou was the winner there. It was absolutely fantastic. Now, put your security blankets away because it's time for the round that we call General Ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. What happens to Dr. Jekyll's trousers when he becomes Mr. Hyde?
And they rip, don't they?
No, they don't rip. Why do they not rip?
Because he's not the Hulk.
And he gets smaller. He becomes smaller and kind of hunched and like a beast.
Yeah, so they should fall down is the answer. Yeah. Because in the book, Edward Hyde is much smaller than Dr. Jekyll. The reason for his short stature is he represents Dr. Jekyll's evil side. So the bit that he's been trying to suppress as he lives as decently and as morally as he can. It's the films and the TV that show him as bigger, more like the Incredible Hulk.
And the Hulk is based on that, isn't it?
Yes, exactly. And Robert Louis Stevenson's tale was inspired by a man called Deacon Brodie. He lived in 18th century Edinburgh, and by day he was the most marvellous, respectable cabinet maker, lock maker, member of the town council. By night, he used the keys that he made to break into their homes and steal their stuff. This is him with his accomplice, George Smith.
Ooh, you think he'd stick out the fact that he was a chicken?
Anyway, Robert Louis Stevenson had a wardrobe as a child at the end of his bed, which had been made by Deacon Brodie. So it's probably how he came to have the idea in the first place. And Brodie was eventually hanged, although the story is that he wore a steel band around his neck and escaped to Paris to live out his life.
I like the idea that you would be hung and they would go, well, don't look, we're hanging him, and just look the other way.
Yeah.
Where's the body gone? Oh, I don't know.
I don't know what happened.
He must have buried himself, I suppose.
Yeah. Finally, what colour is the Emerald City?
I think I know a weird fact about The Wizard of Oz, which I didn't realise until recently, which is that it's an allegory for America. The farmers are the straw man and they need a brain, and industry was the tin man, and industry doesn't have a heart.
Wow.
And the lion was the politicians, and that they didn't have any courage.
You're absolutely right. But it's not what we were looking for. We were looking for the colour.
Well, is the answer green, then?
Hey!
Oh, damn it! I knew something! I knew something!
Yes.
Emerald. Yes. Yellow.
Brown.
No.
Red.
Stop naming colours.
Blue. Teal.
When she first goes to the City of Oz, she is told she must don a pair of protective glasses in order to avoid being blinded by the brightness.
Silver.
I have that when I have laser on my Jack and Danny. They make you wear glasses.
On your what?
On your what?
Jack and Danny.
Jack and Danny?
Jack and Danny, Fanny.
Sorry, it's called a Jack... What is...
A Jack and Danny.
They make you put the glasses on.
No, wait, 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 wait.
Ah. Also,
Jack and Danny.
My mum doesn't like me doing rude stuff and she's really pleased I was going to be on QI.
Right.
And now she's not going to be pleased anymore. She's going to be very embarrassed in front of the gardening club, of course, again.
Speaking of the gardening club, you had all downstairs.
I did not know. It's rhyming slang, is it, Jack and Danny? Who knew?
For Fanny, yeah.
My favourite when I was growing up was always called the a fine china.
Oh.
Mm. Oh, is that your...
Because you get it out for special occasions.
Back to The Wizard of Oz. What we learn from the wizard at the end is that he makes everybody wear green spectacles so that things appear green. And when she asks if that means everything isn't really green, he replies, no more so than any other city, but my people have worn green glasses on their eyes so long that most of them think it really is an emerald city. Everything looks green when viewed through emerald-tinted glasses. And there goes the bell for the end of the school day. Before we leave for playtime, let's have a look at your report cards. In first place tonight... Well, this is astonishing. With a full 5 points, it's Alan! In second place with minus six, it's Lou! In third place with minus 13, Jimmy!
Well, respectable.
Fabulous fourth with minus 26, it's Tom! Thanks to our guests, Tom, Jimmy, Lou and Alan. I leave you with this quick quotation from the quill of American author Robert Benchley. It took me 15 years to discover that I had no talent for writing, but I couldn't give it up because by that time I was too famous. Goodbye. We'll be right back.